Good afternoon, Namaskar. Now we'll start with one of the key sessions of the day, and this session will intend to cover a lot of aspects of supply chain, of biomass, associated industrial growth in terms of briquetting, manufacturing, processing, and then going on to utilization of that commodity in the industry, in boilers, as direct supply chain or O&M, or to do with various other models of utilization. So as a initial start, we would go in a particular sequence from my right, because that'll be easier. And I would like each of our esteemed panelists to use 3 minutes or less. And this is a timed round, so if you cross three, I will just stop you. So it has to be 3 minutes or less. In 3 minutes or less, and this is not applicable to Dr. YB Ramakrishna because he's not representing anybody here. He's an industry thought leader himself. So the balance of you, probably you will take 3 minutes each and describe your either company, your role, in terms of what are you doing in your company, and how do you foresee the future of this industry going ahead. This will be the first round, 3 minutes. Then the second round will be probably a minute and a half each, or maybe 2 minutes each, in which you will cover the challenges you have faced in your journey. How do you see that outlook towards that challenge? And what are the mitigation techniques or recommendations either way, which you have for the industry to carry forward? So this will be the initial theme of our discussion, and then from there, we'll take it ahead. There will be a certain point of insertion where I'll request Dr. YB Ramakrishna to talk a little bit more about the segment, because he's the one of the long-standing people here on our planet, this side of the planet called India, who has seen the entire beginning, the surge, the growth, the mishaps of this industry. So I'll not get you on the first 3 minutes around us, sir. So let them first go through that, and we'll get an opportunity to give you a time to just, you know, give your entire thought process. And post that, we'll try to keep up at least 15 minutes by the clock for the audience to interact directly in terms of suggestions. If you have come up with new ideas post lunch, you are more than welcome. So over to you, Yash. You can go ahead and explain first, please.
Thank you, Rohit ji. Good afternoon, everyone. I guess it's been very tiring session since morning. Lunch ke baad abhi thoda aalas aayega. But some of the points I have noticed in the presentation since morning is biomass from farms to factory, efficiency, transportation, handling raw materials, manual interventions, quality and efficiency. Abhi tak kisi ne, I feel that kisi ne detail mein nahi bola hai ki ye manage kaise kar sakte hain. We have seen transportation of rice husk is bit rice husk ho gaya, paddy husk ho gaya, briquettes ho gaya. It's a bit difficult because people are currently, people are transporting it into illegal vehicles or just trying to send it up to the plant. It's not mattering ki ki hum kaise bhejna hai, kis quality ka bhejna hai, kaise efficiency ho usse bhejna hai. Some of the companies also, they do not care that the trucks are standing outside the plant and so much manual intervention is there, so that ki kaise manual intervention hatai, automation lai aur efficiency increase kare. So I'll give you a very basic example. Maybe it won't be similar to your operation, but agar aaj ki date mein trucks mein agar hum AC companies AC deti hai aur agar hum apne transporters ya drivers ko AC wale truck dete hain, to definitely ek mahine mein wo char trip extra kare, par wo karke dega. Rajasthan ki garmi ho ya south ki garmi, गर्मी तो उसको भी लगती है, हमें लेबर का भी ध्यान रखना होता है, ग्राउंड पे जो हो रहा है उसका भी ध्यान रखना होता है. हम क्वांटिटीज तो ले आएंगे पर प्रोवाइड कैसे करेंगे? इतने देर ट्रक्स बाहर खड़े रहते हैं उसका कोई मैटर नहीं करता. सो दिस इज यशकरन फ्रॉम कीथ वॉकिंग फ्लोर. वी प्रोवाइड ऑटोमेटिक अनलोडिंग टेक्नोलॉजी फॉर ट्रक्स एज वेल एज फॉर ट्रेलर्स. तो अब आज तक हमने देखा है कि राइसर्स को, ब्रिकेट्स हो या कोई भी मटीरियल हो, कंपनीज को क्वालिटी चाहिए. सम वेंडर्स आर ऑल्सो अवेलेबल टू गेट द बेस्ट क्वालिटी, सोने जैसा खरा क्वालिटी देना चाहते, बट उनको कैपिटल इतना डालना पड़ता है या ट्रांसपोर्टेशन इतना डालना पड़ता है कि वो हेजिटेट करते हैं. तो विद आर टेक्नोलॉजी companies can have the efficiency of unloading the same vehicle whenever it arrives within 5 to 7 minutes and enjoy the material. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello. Yeah. Myself, Dhruvil Goradia. Into running the boilers on steam at cost from last more than 25 years. And so it was started by my father, Nitin Goradia. And right now I can say that we are one of the largest green steam supplier pan India. We have our own manufacturing plants, 8 manufacturing plants pan. And we take operation and maintenance contracts and manufacturing briquettes, running boilers on steam at cost. So I was just sitting before lunch. So to save this industry, the biomass fuel industry is the raw material stocking and the sustainability part. So we have to, biomass should be a sustainable sector. So we are here for that. We provide our daily supply of fuel for our own self-consumption and is more than 1200 metric tons of fuel. And right now our production capacity is more than 400 metric tons of briquettes and pellets. And we have our own team of running the boilers of more than 1000 manpower in our team, Pan India. So for the sustainability of the sector, we should have the stocking capacity, proper manpower and everything. So that's it from my side. Thank you. Thank you.
Now I'll introduce you to Preetpal ji. He is a farmer from Punjab. Inki story rahi hai ki shuru se hi inhone muhim kiya hai, shuru kiya hai. Challenges bhi aaye honge. To aap bataiye Preetpal ji, audience ko ki jab aapne shuruaat ki tab biomass ko kaise dekhte the, abhi kya hai और किस तरफ ये सप्लाई चेन की जो मुहिम है खासतौर पर पंजाब में किस ओर जा रही है और अपने कंपनी के बारे में आप बताएं.
सर प्लीज गिव मी 1 मिनट मोर, 3 मिनट एडिशनल. सर माय नेम इज प्रतपाल शर्मा, माय कंपनीज नेम पुष्प, पंजाब यूनिक सर्विस फॉर एग्रीकल्चर वैरायटी. I started my work in biomass in 2004. Then I was a lad. My granny told me a story about a stone that's name was Pars. That stone turns iron into gold. I bent pillar to post to find out that particular stone. After the 17 years work hard, I found that particular stone that turns iron into gold. Now that is in my pocket. Now that stone is in my pocket. How? Because every residues of crop has a color like gold. Wheat straw has a color like gold. Paddy straw has a color like gold. Bamboo, everyone. In the beginning, I started my work with the amount of 4 lakh. Last year, the turnover of my company was 158 crore. Or the next year for 24, in the 24, it will turn into above 300 crore. I am the only first person in this field. Adani is known for his port carwar. Ambani is known for his oil market. Pritpal Sharma is known for collecting biofuel. Last year, I collected 4,77,000 ton paddy straw, 50,000 ton sugarcane trash. Now I have got chance and chance and chance, order and order, order, order. Every time my income turns into double, double, double. Pradhan Mantri ji kehte hain, A square plus B square plus 2AB. That is true for me. Ye aise hi ho raha hai. Jo bhi boiler hame milta hai, 40 crore se kam nahi milta. 15 crore se kam nahi milta. 28 ton se leke 110 ton ke mere paas 16 boiler hain jinko main fuel supply karta hu. Specially ethanol industry sari hamare paas hai, Punjab, Haryana. Crafting, paper crafting industry sari hamare paas hai. Kuch brick plants bhi hain jo naye lage. Main kehta hu, I say, if anybody, though he may be linked in ethanol industry, he may be linked in white paper industry, he may be in brick plants or CBG, bio CBG. I assure him, please do that business. I will provide paddy straw. Cotton stalk, every biofuel according to the viability of that particular area. So, darne ki koi baat nahi. Assam mein kahoge, Assam mein ikattha kar denge. Punjab mein kahoge, Punjab mein ikattha kar denge. North India mein kahoge, South mein kahoge, South mein kar denge. There is no problem collecting biofuel for us. Jitna bhi marzi ikattha karo, quantity, no quantities mentioned matter for us. So I, all the businessmen are sitting here, all the participants, some of them are businessmen, good businessmen, well-known businessmen, renowned businessmen. I do request them, and also the oriented name and ranks are sitting on the dais. I request them all, please, if anybody wants to do work in biofuel, in biomass, if he comes now, first come, first served, if he comes now, no one can compete her, compete him. Koi nahi rok sakda nu agge badhan to. Koi challenge nahi kar sakda. Aaj mauka, today, this is a bar taking about fuel. Now a bar was fought for fuel. The biofuel is only a cheapable, cheapest biomass that can make the viability both the industrialists, vendors and the billers. Biller owners, everybody becomes prosperous, happy, they enjoy the life as they can. So that's my a little bit speech. I again request, because one thing or more, once Colonel Rohit was my CEO, he was also CEO for Prespel. Then I was the aggregator and vendors. I do work for him. I was the biggest supplier at that time. Now myself is the CEO of my company. That also does work the same. Okay, thanks. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you. Sandy, over to you.
Good afternoon, I am Colonel Sandeep. I represent DCM Shriram Limited. DCM Shriram Limited is into multifold businesses, right from caustic soda to H2O2, aluminum chlorides. We are into sugar business, cement business, and distilleries. So for all these business, we have captive power plants. We use coal, but we believe that biofuel is a nature's gift to run our engines. So what we do, we use at least 20 to 40% of biofuels in various ways, be it briquettes, be it loose biomass, be it chipped woody biomass, bamboo, energy cultivation. So all that is done to cater for that 20 to 40% of renewable energy usage. I head the vertical of renewable energy. We are also into solar and wind for the production of power, but that we will not be discussing. We shall focus more on to the biofuel sector. So there are a lot of initiatives which the company has taken in the terms of establishing our own briquetting plants, establishing our own supply chain management teams, having our own storage fields, collection centers. Shall be coming in detail in the later phase of the lecture.
I can go there, right? Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Ashish Kumar. I'm the managing director of Verbio. Verbio is a CBG producer. So the common element here is the biomass. I'm not going to talk about CBG, but just to give a quick introduction, the plant is, from a capacity standpoint, the largest in India. We commissioned the plant last year, and since commissioning, we have sold more than 3,000 tons of CBG till date. So it is already running, operational. It's a fully integrated plant, which means the complete biomass is managed, aggregated, collected by our own resources. I'll focus on the biomass bit of it. Availability of biomass, we have heard since morning, the 200 to 250 million metric tons of biomass which is available, which is a fact. It is neither an opportunity nor a challenge. It is just a fact. It is available. But the form in which it is available on the farm today, it is not really usable, completely usable. And the major reason for that is the quality, right? I think Preetpal ji ne bahut badhiya example diya hai ki availability se acquisition ya collection, right? I think we have to change the narrative that the collection is, I'm a little skeptical, but I would still feel comfortable to share that it is no longer the challenge, right? It will mature, it will need a couple of more years to get better, but it is being done, it is being managed to a decent level. The challenge still remains is the quality of the biomass. And that is where the narrative has to evolve, that let's stop talking just about the volume, let's start focusing on the quality of the biomass. And that's very critical for any application, be it CBG or be it, you know, thermal application, whatever you need. You need a low moisture biomass. When we talk about CBG, we are talking about less than 20 or 25%, and anything more than that is, I can quite safely say, it's pretty useless. So to get those kind of quality levels are still the challenging part over here. So that's something which we need to understand. What has changed in the last, let's say, 1-2 years is there has been a lot of push on the mechanization part. So the collection has become more automated, more mechanized, and that is why we are able to see that there is a sizable volume which is still being able to be managed by us,
by companies like Pusa Balers and a lot of other players. So collection to some extent is becoming, it is being managed. Quality needs to be focused on. The other thing where, which still continues to be a challenge when you are working with aggregators or any entrepreneur, is the working capital management during that particular period. So that is also something which, and there are provisions, there are schemes like Agriculture Infrastructure Fund available, which does provide low interest financing, but still it is hardly utilized. Maybe due to lack of awareness or due to maybe some bureaucratic hurdles over here. So this is also something which needs to be made more easily accessible. Quality, again, I will just comment one more point related to quality is that we do not have the right measuring instruments also. And I'm telling you this is a fact because I have seen a measuring instruments of moisture. Even if you dip it in water, they do not show a reading more than 35 or 40%. Right, so that is the quality of instrumentation which is available locally, which basically means I again need to depend on imports. And this is the challenge which we have to work with. Even for the mechanization, when we talk about large stock collection machinery, it's still import dependent. All these precision based instruments are again import dependent. So that's a missing gap over here. I learned in the morning that people are expecting a premium on high moisture, and I found it very amusing. I think it's the other way around, that we have to link premiums with low moisture and not with high moisture, right? And this is what we are doing at Verbio at the moment. So I give you a concrete example. So if the market rate is anything between, let's say, 1600 to 1800 rupees per ton, we would give a premium of anything between 15 to 25%, depending on what kind of moisture I'm getting. And that is the practice which at an industry level one should be encouraging. It is performance based, right? So why should I squeeze if the other party is slogging and getting the best quality out, then he also deserves a premium. And that's what something which needs to be encouraged. So that's another point. We do not talk about transportation much in the supply chain, and that becomes a big bottleneck over here, because once you have collected and baled everything and it's lying on the farms, and it keeps lying on the farm for the next couple of days because of, let's say, insufficient logistics, the trolley, tractor, trolley transportation system which exists. But the biggest, along with quality, the second biggest challenge which still continues is the storage infrastructure. There is almost, I would say, zero support when it comes to any kind of policies, provisions, as far as creating a storage infrastructure for this biomass is concerned. Because once the aggregator has done his job of collection, right, he is handing over that risk to the end consumer. So that end consumer has got to take care of it, protect it, store it for the rest of the year, right? So the risk has been transferred, right? So the risk is much more, and the cost is also much more. So let's say if the cost of acquisition is anything between 1600 to 1800, we are talking about farm to feed cost. Farm to feed cost, roughly about 3000 rupees plus minus per ton, right? So there is a cost of storage, there is a cost of storage infrastructure creation, insurance we talked about in the morning. So if I factor in all these costs, and in on top we are talking about a protection mechanism, because you just can't put it under the sun. You've got to protect it from two culprits, fire and water, right? So all these add up to the cost, and I'm not even factoring a shed. The moment you bring in a shed, the cost will still further go up. We are talking about protection by using tarpal, you know, the desi style of protecting it, and that is what leads to a cost of farm to feed up to, let's say, 3000 rupees per ton plus minus. So that is the second biggest challenge one has to deal with. The third topic which I would like to highlight here is, it is not a challenge, but I think this is where the industry, the supply industry, has to evolve to. We need to come to a just-in-time kind of a supply over here, right? Why am I, you know, not getting the feed on a daily basis like I do get in automotive industry or any other industry, right? So that means the aggregator needs to up his game and not just be the collector, but also maybe take over the role of storage also.
right? I'm not trying to pass the risk to him. This is also something which can be jointly taken up, right? So as to manage the risk between the both the parties over here, and we are absolutely open to receiving proposals, inputs on these kind of topics, right? So this is the third point I would like to make. Just to conclude, I think the industry, be it CBG or any of the biomass related industry, we are in a very nascent stage, and I think the market dynamics are changing on a very rapid pace at the moment, right? But the policy update has to keep pace with it, and that is at times you get stuck with it, because yes, there is a policy, but the policy has not evolved as rapidly as the market is evolving. And this is where you feel stuck at times, that despite of having a policy framework, but it is not as, you know, fast moving as the industry is moving at the moment. So that is my request to the policy makers over here. I'll be happy to take any questions later. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everybody. First of all, I thanks and congratulate IFGE for organizing this need of the hour conference on biomass densification. Myself, Ankur Mittal, and I am from National Council for Cement and Building Materials. This is an autonomous organization under Ministry of Commerce, Government of India, and it takes care of each and every services related to cement industry, whether it's engineering, testing, whether it's education and other things. So ISO 14064, it tells the definition of this biomass. It is a material of biological nature, excluding the material that is embedded in a geological formation and material that has been transformed into fossilized material. Indian cement industry, it is having capacity of around 594 million tons. That is the second largest globally. And it is a very energy intensive sector, and also blamed for emitting 7% of anthropogenic emissions. It is struggling for its sustainability, as only 60% of capacity is being utilized as on date. So there is a limitation of raw material as well as limitation of fuel. And in the childhood, we have all heard a story of thirsty crow, that necessity is the mother of invention. So cement industry, it's also working extremely good for uses of alternative fuel, and this is the result that thermal substitution rate, it has increased to 6%. Now coming to the topic of today, that is biomass. So in this 6% TSR, or in total use of alternative fuel, 14% share is of only biomass. There are a number of challenges for using biomass. So there is a challenge of availability. The physical and chemical properties of biomass that are available, that are heterogeneous of nature. So there are issues of engineering in the cement plants. But this session that is targeted for supply chain management, this is a very key issue related to the use of biomass in the cement industry. As if I take example of Delhi NCR, so there is an annual generation of biomass that is 28 million tons, but there is no cement plants in Delhi NCR that is producing an intermediate material of cement, that is clinker. So material is here, but due to shortage of limestone reserves, the cement plants are not planned here. So supply chain management, it can tackle issues for uses of biomass that has itself potential of giving a TSR of 10%. So when we add up this number to the total TSR, that is 6%, so it will be a 16%. So this number, it looks small, but it will be greater than the total quantity used by some of the European countries. So if the time permits, I'll share a case study for this supply chain management. So I thank you, the organizer, and I hand over to the next speaker.
Thank you, Ankurji. Harvirji, please.
Thank you. Hello. Thank you, and good afternoon to everybody. It's interesting to be here in this gathering. Actually, professionally, I'm a journalist, and very close to my heart is close to farming community. And we are talking about green energy and this biomass, uses of biomass, and this session is about the management of biomass feedstock. Actually, if we talk about this alternate fuel and the green energy, two factors are behind that it has come up, like one is pollution, another is a surplus. If people are here from industry, those who talks about ethanol and all, ethanol is basically comes only due to surplus sugar and cane prices not being paid, suppose the farmer without new revenue stream or so, and sugar industry also using biomass in boilers and all. And another part is that when we talks about pollution in Delhi and NCR, everybody talks about stubble burning in Haryana, Punjab, Western UP, even in Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan. So now it's the main, I think it has come into the mainstream now as a fuel. And when he talks about it, that who is the basically, from where you will get the feedstock? It will, maybe it may come from the forest or so, but main feedstock supplier is farmer. And without the main stakeholder, we have talked about industry, and definitely industry is using this feedstock and sourcing the material, but it will come from the farmer's field, whether it is wheat straw or whether it is paddy straw. And if it talks about why farmers burn straw in their field, because they get very small window of 20 to 25 days after harvesting paddy, and they are supposed to plant basically so wheat. In this such a small period, they have just simple solution to burn it and to go for the next crop, and it brings the pollution. But definitely there is a valuable commodity which can be used for energy, and it is being used. So right now, whatever quantity is being sourced from the fields, it's very small quantity. There is huge potential, but without involving the farmer, without incentivizing the farmer, it will not be, I think, a great success. Everybody is talking that huge quantity is available. One of our fellow speaker told that whatever quantity you need, we are ready to supply, because it is available. And now it is not just you have to burn it into boiler. You can get ethanol. Now 2G ethanol can be, you can produce through this paddy straw and all. And I think some entrepreneurs are starting in Punjab somewhere. I came to this thing to ground my knowledge that someone is putting a plant near Rajpura or so, like that. So, and from cane you are getting ethanol. Government is focusing on this ethanol blending program now. They want to go in 25, 26 up to 20%, E20 we are talking about, E20. And reason is that it will save your valuable forex, as well as will reduce the pollution. At the same time, it is also creating a big ecosystem of like sugar industry or farmers or all these things all together. And but at the same time, if we don't have a clear cut policy on that, and there are some limitations about the mechanization of such a short span, you need to have the, I don't know, very small number we have these baler units. If suppose someone wants to collect the stubble from the farm, you are talking about the way how to handle this waste and to transport it. If you have a modern system, you can do that. But my point is, again, without incentivizing the farmer to get the main stakeholder involved into all kind of this activity, it will not be a success story. You need to basically involve them, to educate them. And I was just talking to one of the senior, very, very knowledgeable scientists from the agriculture side, that if we can come out with some pilot project successfully, and we can incentivize the farmer and to create an ecosystem, so that will be a, and then we can replicate that in a bigger way. so that industry will also come, investment will come, farmer will get money. At the same time, we should integrate the carbon credit system also, so that farmers get some extra incentive, or we talk about the additional farmer income, better farmer income. So it is not just agro-produce, it may come through the waste also. So these are the points I want to make here. Let us see further.
Thank you, Abhijit. Anandji, please.
Good afternoon all. Myself, Anant Bansal from 3E Sustainable Solutions, 3E Bioethan Sustainable Solutions Private Limited. We are into trading of biomass briquettes and pellets, and we also have our own plants in MP and Rajasthan. We have four plants with a capacity of 150 tons each, where we are producing briquettes and pellets from mustard and sawdust. I have been trading this commodity since 2010 from different people also. So I have approximately 200 manufacturers connected to me, and likewise 250 or plus companies connected, where we are supplying this biomass in form of briquettes and pellets for their fuel needs. And also in last 2 years, we have started consulting to people who want to get into this field, because we have a wide experience of 25 plus years. And now we are helping people set up briquetting and pelleting units and run them in a sustainable way. That is what we are doing right now.
Thank you, Anjali. So before we go for the next round with our panelists, I would request Dr. I.B. Ramakrishna to talk about his experience and his observations in this sector. What is ailing, where are we failing, and what is the way ahead. So over to you, sir.
Very good afternoon to all of you. And I also wish you a very happy World Biofuel Day. Actually, 10th is the World Biofuel Day. It is being celebrated today, tomorrow, and for the rest of the week in different parts of the country. So you all live in this sector. I think it's time for me to wish you. I slightly make a different presentation today. Essentially, looking at the kind of new opportunities that this group has when it comes to the bioenergy program. I came to know that there are nearly about 8,000 registered units producing biopellets and briquettes in the country, and I don't know how many of them are really functional and how many of them are really profitable at this point of time. And as I see it, one of the critical challenge that the industry would be facing is the feedstock supply chain. And of course, there are other issues like availability all through the year, storage facility, and then the market, etc., etc. And as a sector, you do have quite a few challenges, even when you are really looking at addressing the market of heat and of late, biomass for electricity generation also. But I am pretty sure that the forum that has been created now will be looking into all those kind of challenges that you have and really look at how they can facilitate the policy interventions that may be required, and also from time to time through the interactions provide you inputs for making your own business sustainable. But the point that I am trying to make is at the kind of new opportunities that we have, and as people who are a very important link in the entire value chain, the kind of new opportunities that are there for you to consider as we move forward. Now, that brings me to the biofuel program that is being taken up in this country with the right kind of earnest in the last, 8 to 9 years now. And we all know that, we have quite an aggressive ethanol program. We have now Satat program, which is taking shape, where we are talking about biomass. And as we look into the future, We are also looking into sustainable aviation fuels and also looking into a lot of biomaterials and biochemicals that will be produced in future. All those kind of, whether it is fuels or materials, essentially coming from the fossil fuels will have to be replaced with biofuel, especially the, when the whole world is talking about energy transition, when they are talking about net zero kind of scenario. I think biofuels and biomaterials, they play a very important role. Now, if you, the moment we talk about, let us say, ethanol, you know, we all think that, oh, ethanol comes from molasses, and then, you know, you have government as a program from grains. So where is the kind of opportunity that we have? And then if you really look at biomass route, the capex is so high, opex is so high. There are one or two small industries here and there, but not many are in the place. We don't know when it is going to happen. But let me tell you, you know, this morning also, Sangeeta, you were also there in that SIAM meeting. And again, you know, we were talking about the sustainable feedstock supply chain there also. The way I see it is that, you know, whether it is especially the ethanol program, from the molasses route or from the grain route, you know, I considered this as a low-hanging fruit as far as our ethanol program is concerned. There is a limitation. Maybe about 10 to 15 billion liters of ethanol can be produced through these routes, and then these two routes get saturated. But then our requirement, if you really look at it, say for example, for our 20% blending, we require about 10 billion liters, and then we are also talking about E100, where over a period of time we are really looking at completely replacing the petrol with ethanol. And then we are talking about sustainable aviation fuel, you know, where we require another 8 to 10 million metric tons of this sustainable aviation fuel in the coming days. And when India becomes a signatory to CARSIA, then if you don't produce the sustainable aviation fuel in this country, then international traffic will not come to India. So it's a very tricky kind of a situation where we have to get into this area. And one route is ethanol. Whether it is ethanol or the lipid route, ultimately we are talking about biomass, various types of biomass route for converting that into sustainable aviation fuel. And of course the materials, chemicals, you know, it's a huge market. So as against what the sugar industry or the grain industry can support, up to about 15 billion liters of ethanol, we are looking at, in next 15-20 years, the ethanol market itself be somewhere around 40 to 50 billion liters. And that extra ethanol has to only come through the, the biomass route. So that's a huge opportunity here. And even again, you know, when we are talking about the biogas opportunity also, we are talking about various other types of waste streams like animal dung. Then you are talking about municipal solid waste. But what I think is going to be very sustainable is the feedstock, the biomass feedstock that will be required for the biogas program also. So, there is a huge market opportunity, much, much bigger than what we are looking at this point of time for heat and electricity kind of market. Now, what are the important and critical aspects that, you have to really look at? As I mentioned, one of the major challenge that the industry has been facing is the feedstock supply chain. Now, if you set up a industry hoping that feedstock is going to be available to me as a commodity in the market, you are not going to succeed. It may happen, 15-20 years from now, but who is going to make it happen? And I believe that this is an initiative that has to be taken by the people who are thinking in terms of processing. Anyway, if you really look at, closely examine the role, you have been consolidating and getting from different sources your biomass, you are stocking it all through the year, converting that into pellets or briquettes and supplying it to for a different application to another industry. So that role that you have to be playing, now you have to be thinking in terms of multiple different applications. For that to happen, backward integration becomes very important and very critical. Now I am very happy, Sharma ji was talking about as an individual and a small company that he has started, been able to aggregate more than 4 to 4.5 lakh tons of paddy straw in a year. Believe me, that is good enough to run 3 second generation ethanol plants, the one that has been set up by IOCL in Panipat, which has become functional. And that is good enough to run 5 Verbio plants that you know, Ashish has been talking about. One person can support 3 big 2G ethanol plant, 5 big biogas plant. I mean, just imagine the kind of you know, possibilities that are there. I would suggest that every single you know, pellet or you know, the briquette manufacturer has to think in terms of how do we aggregate the biomass that is available and how do we store it. And processing knowledge and market part is something that you are already aware of. So backward integration becomes very important. The, as far as the forward integration is concerned, the new markets that I am talking about may not require the biomass in the form of pellets and briquettes. You know, they may require it in different sizes and shapes and different formats. Say for example, you know, for the biogas or for the 2G ethanol, the size has to be reduced, and you know, you cannot go for densification. Densification becomes important when you are talking about storage or transportation. But the industry itself requires it in, you know, different industries requires it in different format. So we have to think in terms of, you know, what are the kind of industries that we are going to be addressing in future, and how do we cater to their needs in future. This is something that I think the industry has to think of, apart from looking at the kind of challenges and solutions that we had to find as on today. You know, this new opportunities that are there also needs to be looked into by this august audience, and also I believe that the forum that has been created also should support that kind of you know, transition in future. I'll just stop at this.
Definitely, sir. Thank you for that insight. So let's get along with some solution finding, and I will, you know, allude to some problem statements first. So you heard both Yash and Ashish talk about an aspect which generally goes amiss in the supply chain forums, is the logistic part. So if you see the first mile connectivity, and the question will come to both you and Ashish. Yash, first you. The first mile connectivity, like he illustrated, is, you know, tractor trolley kind of an arrangement. There is a requirement of capex investment because you need to get the trolleys in shape. They cost a particular amount of money. There is a bandwidth of these current manufacturers of these trolleys per annum. They can make X quantity only. Whereas, if you see Punjab itself, there's a huge demand to transition, and if all goes well and if HPCL starts working, you have 20 projects of CBG running in that state. This entire first mile connectivity in terms of logistics is not there, A. B, when you convert it into a form factor and say we are talking about densification today, then again there is a connectivity which is the midway connectivity which has to go through. But both are currently, to my understanding as well, like you elucidated and also Ashish actually pointed out, unstructured. So today when you make a briquette, you go by the mandi rates, you pick up the first person, the average size of you know, trucking in India is 5 trucks ownership, I'm not counting TCAs of the world. When you come to the rear side of the mechanism, the trolleys are not there. So you have to provide for trolleys because the farmer is not willing to invest currently. There are all kinds of you know, combinations, some do. So would a company like yours, which is into a niche sector kind of a trucking capability today, while you are selling those trucks for people to unload in an easier way or load, would you look at this logistic supply chain as well? What are your thoughts going ahead? What should be this first mile connectivity both to the processing unit and beyond that thereafter for the midway transportation? And similarly, you know, once you have your thoughts around, we'll take the question back to Ashish as well, because he has got deep understanding of that particular activity happening. So over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Rohit. So the first point, I would like to clear it out that we only provide automatic unloading technology. And currently in India, whenever a briquetting manufacturer wants to send the material to the plant, or any trader wants to send the material to the plant, they just find it out who is the cheapest transporter. They want to transport it. No one wants to take care of the transportation, handling of the material, whether it's going in a wood box or is it efficiently going. कि 32 फुट की गाड़ी है, उसमें मैं 20 टन 25 टन जो मेरा आउटपुट है दिन का वही भेज रहा हूँ. क्या मैं उसी में 40 टन का माल भेज सकता हूँ क्या? एफिशिएंसी इज मोर इम्पॉर्टेंट. मार्केट में जो पहली गाड़ी मिलती है वो भेज देते हैं. वी डू नॉट हैव अ डेडिकेटेड सिस्टम, डेडिकेटेड ट्रकिंग सिस्टम. लाइक फॉर एग्जाम्पल सीमेंट प्लांट, कोई भी रॉ मटेरियल आता है सीमेंट प्लांट में तो दे द ट्रेलर और अ ट्रक इज एबल टू हैंडल द सीमेंट बैग्स हॉल बैक. तो वैसे ही जैसे अब प्लांट में जाते हैं कहीं पे भी हमने बायोमास दिया एनी टाइप ऑफ बायोमास, तो व्हाइल हॉलिंग बैक इफ द ट्रांसपोर्टर इज ऑल्सो एबल टू गेट द फ्लाई ऐश कॉन्टेंट, एनी ऑफ द रेसिड्यू कॉन्टेंट दैट नीड्स टू ऑल्सो बी टेकन केयर ऑफ, दैट इज ऑल्सो बीन हैंडल्ड. एंड एज आशीष जी सेड 3,000 rupees पर टन इज जस्ट द कॉस्ट फ्रॉम फार्म टू द अनलोडिंग लोकेशन और टू द फीडिंग प्लेस. So we need to find out the points where we can reduce 200 rupees from this space, 500 rupees from this space. At least 3000 ka 2200 to hoga, 2200 to hoga, 2800 to hoga. Something could be found out. That's one of the thing.
Anybody here who's from a logistic company, by any chance? Because I saw one registration of a logistic company. Are you here? No. Okay, Ashish, over to you, please. What are your thoughts on how to curate this system?
So, I think when we talk about logistic companies, they don't deal with biomass. That's my understanding, right? I'm talking current, right? So, logistics normally means trucking in India and not tractor and trolleys. So, we are not yet there. I think the solution is basically capex. I mean, you will have to invest in tractor, trolley. There is no shortcut to it. You need capex and you need working capital. Otherwise, there is no way to deal with it. And you need continuous operation during the season, which basically means you are working on three shifts. You can't afford to be working on one shift. You have to ensure that the feedstock gets collected from the farm, ideally within 24 hours, if not at least within 48 or 72 hours. If it is lying on the farm for more than 2, 3, 4 days, then there is you're just adding to the risk. I don't really have much more to add to it. It's capex, working capital. It's all about funding.
Thanks, Ashish. Coming to you, Dhruvil. So there's always a sort of a decision dilemma. You have a particular amount of money, you can raise a particular amount of money, and there's also always a plan for expansion, right? So you are a particular scale of revenue today, XYZ, and you have a window of opportunity, which is unlimited currently. So you could as well as go to 40 more people tomorrow and offer O&M or boot services, whatever you want to do, in partnership or individually. So how do you plan in this industry? Because how do you want to shape it? Because 25 years is a long time since your father started this journey, and you're going to take it ahead. So how do you see next 10 years correlating your company's growth to the growth of this segment, which is dealing with purely densified biomass and its utilization? So any thoughts on that probably? And how do you intend getting in the infusion, money? Are you looking at in some kinds of equity? At what stage of growth you want to go there? So just to give an experience, because there are a lot of people from the banking sector here as well, they will understand your pain points of normal routine working capital first. What is your requirement of capex for growth? If you can put some number for them to understand, it'll be good. So we can take this conversation ahead.
Hello. Hello.
Yeah, it's fine. So right now we are looking for the equity, because to stock the raw material, the warehousing thing and everything, and to take the steam contracts, boot projects. So we are looking for equity and talks are going on. So in this biomass, the stocking and the warehousing needs lots of funds. So right now we are looking for equity. And so your next question?
I just wanted to understand the next phase of your growth. How do you want to plan for it in terms of money, in terms of manpower, whatever you're thinking about? So you're in a current phase of X revenue. In 5 years, you want to be 3X, 4X. Define that. And how do you want to reach there? And what support do you seek from the banking segment?
Yeah, so last year revenue was 200 crores. So we are looking to double it by
next year or in within 2 years. So we need banking support and everything in this field, biomass field right now. And yeah, that's it right for me. Thank you.
We'll come to that again. I think I'll take it to even Ashish. So Sandeep, you are from an hard to abate sector. And very recently, the sector has been driving to take in anything to burn in the boiler, right? Whether you take RDF, you take any other refuse, you take biomass. So the quantum of utilization is fast increasing in your segment. So as a person who is the lead in DCM Shriram, if you could just tell us what are your sustainability goals you're looking at, how to achieve that, and in a particular project per se, a plant, what are the transitions you're looking at in terms of utilization of biomass?
I shall cover this in two parts. Firstly, what do we do is we utilize about 400 to 500 metric tons of biomass every day. So that is at our Kota plant and also at the Bharuch plant. The problem areas. The problem area is because these are thermal plants, power plants, and we compete with the coal. The coal prices changes every week in line with the coal index, but the biomass is fixed because the biomass is bought during the harvest time and it is converted into briquettes during the monsoons. There are additional charges, so there is no change. There is only increase in biomass rates, especially during the monsoons, and also there is no up and down like what you have the coal index. So that becomes a problem when the profit or P&L statements are taken. That's a big problem. Okay. If that's a problem, to mitigate this problem, what do we do? I think that should be a little interesting. Hum kare kya? So we have taken certain initiatives. Like these initiatives are, we have started using biomass in a hammered form. So that gives us an advantage. It increases the GCV. Whatever foreign bodies, whatever mud is available in the loose biomass, we get it hammered with our local made hammer mills and utilize that increases the GCV of the biomass. This is one initiative which we have taken in Kota. Second is we have got into this energy plantations. Knowing that we have a mandate of using 20% at least of the biomass, so we have gone into bamboo cultivations. So now it's not all types of bamboo, there are about 1300 species of bamboo. So which bamboo would be the best suitable for a thermal power plant? So we had done a lot of R&D on that and we came across a clone of a species called Bambusa balcoa, which is called in Indian name Bhima bamboo, which is very thick. It's 155 mm thickness and it grows very fast. Very fast, when I say it grows about 3 feet in a day, and the length of one bamboo can be around 25 meters, and the total time it takes to grow is about 2.5 years. And the best part is that the bamboo, it is under the species of grass, so it is pure biomass. It doesn't come under the tree species, so there is no problem with the forest from the forest department that you are cutting the tree. So because it's a grass, so that is one cultivation which we are getting into. We are helping out the farmers, the tribals. In the morning, somebody had asked ki jungle mein jo patte vagera bil jate hai, uska kya hota hai ki there is a in forest rights 2006, there is a clause which says that jo jungle ka product hai, that is to be used by the dwellers, by the tribals. It's called commodity reserve rights. So whatever that commodity, jo bhi jungle ki commodity hai, it is to those jungle dwellers, the tribals. So if somebody is buying that, say patta kutti koi khareed raha hai, from that income goes to those jungle dwellers. In our case, we are utilizing this unused land or green wastelands which are declared by the forest departments. We do an capex investment in that. We cultivate the bamboo and have a routine every frequent supply of bamboo, which is used as bamboo chips in our boilers. So these are two initiatives which we have taken. And the third initiative is that we have started our own briquetting plants in various models, and two pelleting plants too in various models. We did not directly get involved. We have given the operational and maintenance to various firms, and we would be establishing certain more. Around 14 more are coming in about a year's time, the briquetting plants.
Thank you, Sandeep. Ankurji, coming to you as a, just a follow from this, so same similar industry. What would be your recommendations for any kind of a policy initiation to help your sector better? So what kind of policies would you like to be formulated?
Thank you, sir. This is a very good question. So actually, the policy that is required to cater the requirement of cement industry, that is of alternative fuel, that is related to the supply chain management. And for that, I like to present a model case study. So in India, there is an annual generation of 500 million tons of this biomass kind of material. And in Delhi NCR, there is a generation of paddy stubble of 28 million tons in a year. So now, including a lighter note, during our study time, there used to be two breaks. One was summer break and another was winter break. But unfortunately, there is one more break added to our children. That is a pollution break that comes after Diwali. So two breaks were for enjoying. Now this break is for fear. So this paddy stubble is the residue part of paddy crop. So out of this 28 million tons, 11 million tons is burnt in the open space. Problem is that there is no policy, no incentivization for farmers so that they can get a good price and to shift from burning crops to supply to the needy industry. Now, there could be a model of supply chain management. So some collection center, they can be established at a district level as well as the state level. So farmers, they can supply this paddy stubble in form of bales to the district collection center. And after that, there is a choice. Either it may be transferred to the cement industry in form of pallet, or if we see a bigger picture, so it may be transported to the state collection centers and can be supplied further to the cement plants. There could be another solution, and they also require some policy intervention that cement plants, they face challenge of related to the quality or changing quality of this biomass. So if this biomass, it can be converted from solid form to gases form through gasification process. So the problem related to the quality of this fuel, it can be addressed. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Harvir ji, I'll ask you an offbeat question right now because you said you're from media. So when the stubble burning starts, two things happen in Indian media, right? So A, they say parali, 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 and B, they say don't celebrate Diwali, right? So the causes are different. You have been a journalist, and the causes of this smog is different as well. It's not only parali. But what should we do as an endeavor to get more media focus into this activity on a nearly year-round, kind of an activity to promote awareness, to promote even things like what SGGJ does in terms of skill development, in terms of industry stakeholders, getting together collaborations to talk about it in business summits, to talk about investment in the sector. So there's a lot of role which media can do, because they have media shows. I mean, I go for nearly all of them on all themes. And the only lip service I find is in the energy sector, where they just pick up two or three branded people who have probably made a software somewhere, and they come into prominence. But people who are working on ground and creating these ecosystems don't come. So what would be kind of a strategy we can involve, or we can have some policy initiation, and even things like, for example, if this is a forum going on, and if there are three ministers, so every ministry could have some kind of a linkage to the media when you need to cover events and propagate. So they could actually be an enabler, but they actually become news machines only for a couple of months. So what did you say?
You are right. Actually, you see, whenever there is a negativity and you get all kind of coverage in mainstream media, whether it is electronic media or whether it is print media or now a digital media, you will find it everywhere. And people will say that Delhi gets chopped and you may be sick and this is the problem. The Supreme Court also gets intervened and there is some policy initiative also. But point is that this half-heartedly initiative and definitely information is very important and awareness is really can play a very important role in it and can create a I think one can move toward the solution if there is a right information campaign and media is also supposed to be used for a positive side of this problem because this is one can say that any stubble is being burning. Suppose in some part of Ludhiana or Jalandhar or Tarantaran, entire this fumes comes towards Delhi. It is not the way. People suffer in those areas also, and it is not. Actually, I am a farmer also. Since my childhood, we have seen when we harvest the cane and cane leaves are there, we get it burned because we have to show the wheat or some other crop or the. It's like that. So definitely at that time pollution must have been like that. Now you are losing trees in urban areas, more and more urbanization is happening. We should see all the side of the problem and we should go towards the solution. And on solution, see, you will find that there is a Ministry of Environment and Climate Change and Forest all. Now there is a big name, I have the ministry, long name. Then you have this health ministry, then you have agriculture ministry, then you may find some urban development ministry. But point is again, where is the coordination? Even if you will find, even this current year budget, the allocation to resolve this issue, I think it was cut down from that. These things must come out. And it's the right time to address this issue because now you have the solution. You have this a very big focus on this alternate fuel and now people are talking about carbon credit. So point is that we need a proper ecosystem. We have to make farmers more aware and at the same time, but you have to go to the for solution must come at the local level. You must find the uses of this bio waste or biomass at the local level. You cannot say that suppose you are transporting this paddy waste from or paddy straw from the one place to 100 kilometer or 200 kilometer or 500 kilometers. Why can't we put a small plant nearby or the industry which is supposed to use that kind of stuff? So why suddenly if you see one example I want to give, why entire this plywood industry concentrating in near Yamunanagar? Because government allowed a certain kind of species as agroforestry and you will find the farmers are growing these poplar tree and eucalyptus for supplying to this industry. So it has given a new revenue stream to the farmers also. It gives the green cover also. So point is that you have to think in a holistic manner where all these stakeholders comes together and now there is an opportunity industry also can invest into this new energy solutions and but government has to incentivize. Like we, someone was talking in earlier session that there is a scheme, this agriculture infrastructure fund. So 1 lakh crore fund, government announced in a big way. I don't know whether anybody is aware about what amount government spent in the last fiscal on that fund. This is a fund. This is a loan amount government announced that government will give a 1 lakh crore for agriculture infrastructure creation. But that is a interest subvention and low interest rate loan. That is not a fund. One should be very clear about that. I think less than 200 crore interest subvention was given the last fiscal for that. So, but what is the criteria? And there are many schemes like that. Like that, even this there are farm mechanization schemes also for on this to address this stubble issue. So point is that you are first looking toward the problem, and you just want to like even I don't want to hesitate to point out here, the Delhi government said that there is a particular solution is available, this Pusa some solution that you can spray in the field and it will done. I think they spend more money on advertisement instead of giving money to the farmer to supply that chemical to the farmer. Maybe 100 times more to the advertisement. So definitely awareness is important, but you have to make aware the real stakeholder who can utilize that money or that information to resolve this issue. And in that case, I appreciate and I congratulate you, because I am attending a first of this kind of conference in NCR. But you should also go to the local level. You must go to, with these kind of conferences and this campaign to the local level. You must go to Panipat, you must go to Karnal, to Meerut, or you must go to Ludhiana or Moga, because where the issue is lying, and so that farmer also will find out there is a solution to this problem. It is not just after harvesting the paddy, you just want to burn it and want to go for another crop. So if they also want money, if they see some value into it, and there is a reliable solution or someone is there to buy that stuff. So I just heard that this biomass costs 3,000 per ton from the place from field to factory. So I'm surprised, you know, the cane price the farmer get is just 3,000 rupees per ton. And what does cane has? Cane has the every solution. Cane has water, cane has energy, cane has sugar, cane has ethanol, so and fertilizer. So I think in that proposition it's a very costly affair. So we have to look all these things and to find a solution, and maybe definitely I'm confident it's a very good time, it's the right time we are talking about this, and government is also focusing a lot, but we need more focus. And basically any scheme or any plan must be with incentive. You must incentivize the farmer or to the user or to the industry. So you cannot go in piecemeal that you suppose you want to incentivize the industry but not the farmer. You want to incentivize the farmer but not to the industry. So there should be a complete proper solution for this issue, and it is an opportunity. We must convert this problem into opportunity, and now this is the right time. We have the option to do that. Thank you.
Thank you. So before we go to the last round, one comment from Anandji. You being very fresh into diversifying your business, what are the three challenges which you face as an entrepreneur?
Yeah, before I go that could do that, I'd like to add one point. Like you were just discussing how to make people aware.
Right.
So there is an organization called PCRA. So they do a lot of awareness campaigns for conservation of petroleum products. So we should have a similar awareness campaign for biomass also. Conserve coal and use biomass. So that kind of awareness, if it is available through radio or TV on a regular basis, that right. will bring a big change in consumption of biomass and offtake. Yes, and as you are asking about the challenges that we are facing, is there a lot of schemes available, and they are available in different pockets. So there is no one single window where you get all the information. Like rightly said, Agri Infra Fund is there. They are offering 3% subvention of interest. But at the same time, there is a limit of 2 CR to that. Whereas government has increased the limit of loan to 5 CR. So that subvention should also be for 5 CR. So there is a gap between the policies within the government framework. So these gaps should be fulfilled, and as the sector has been listed in the priority sector, we don't see priority lending, because ultimately the lending portion is through banks, and banks take all the precautions in giving a loan. They do all the checks and balances. even if you go for a collateral free loan, there are a lot of things that have to be checked before giving a loan. Government is giving a 75% guarantee of the loan. Even then, you have to fulfill around 50 to 60% of the amount you are taking. You have to show the guarantee that yes, you can pay back that much amount. Then where is the gap? The government is ready to give the scheme, but the farmer or the end user is not getting it. So these are the few places where we need some intervention from BGAF, where these policies can be tweaked and made comfortable for the entrepreneurs.
Thank you, Anandji. So before we go to the audience, I would request Dr. Vaibhi Ramakrishna for your last thoughts on what you have heard till now, and before we go to the next session. Your thoughts till now, sir, of what you have heard.
Taking clue from what Colonel Sandeep ji said, they have one of the things that they have been doing is that, they have started growing bamboo for their own requirement. And for the very sustainability of this industry, I think, I did talk about the backward integration. One thing that we have to consider is that, when we are talking to a farmer, we should not just be looking at a buyer-seller kind of a relationship, but consider him as a important stakeholder and as an important partner in your business. Now, they can grow the bamboo because they had some land where nothing was being grown, but then all industries may not have enough land. But I think, working with the farming community and making sure that they, in addition to the food that they grow, they also grow the kind of feedstock that may be required is one thing that you have to consider. Now, when I say this, I'm saying this basically because, bamboo, there have been so much of research work that has gone in on various different types of feedstock ideally suited for our energy program. Bamboo is one, you have napier grass, there is so much of work that has been done on, sweet sorghum and pearl millets. So there are some crops where you get not only the grains, but also you get tremendous amount of biomass. The selection of this feedstock has to be based on ultimately who is the customer that I am serving, what his requirements and needs are. So this is something that we have to keep in mind, and building that kind of a relationship with the farming community becomes very important. The other point that I would like to make is that if you really look at the biomass availability in the country, there were some studies that we had done in the past. 11 major crops, we have generate something like 1.1 billion metric tons of agri residues. And most of it is being used, but still you have something like 200 million metric tons of it which is being burnt on the farmer's field. And what we see being burnt as paddy straw in Punjab, Haryana and western parts of UP is probably only about 40-50 million metric tons in a year. But you have another 150 million metric tons of different types of biomass which is being burnt in different parts of the country. Now, the first thing is that do we even know where this kind of biomass is available and what is the kind of characterization of the biomass, whether it is really suited for our industry, etc., is something that we had to really worry about. This is where that study that I mentioned, it was an only a initiative with 11 crops, and then there was a initiative with the National Remote Sensing Agency of Hyderabad, where they did the mapping. Today, out of this 11 crop, for about 5 crops, you have through the satellite technology, you have 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer grid, where what is the kind of biomass that is available, agri residue that is available, how much it is being generated, and when it gets generated, and how much is the surplus. All this kind of work has been done. Now, on the one side, this database that is being created needs to be strengthened. It has to be made dynamic. You know, maybe we have to think in terms of more crops, etc. And then we have to also look at this biomass characterization so that, you know, for different application, what biomass is ideally suited. So that would, that kind of, you know, strengthening the existing database and having access to every single person who is in this field, you know, to this kind of database would, I think, would really help a lot in planning their feedstock supply chain and also in looking at, you know, different, addressing the needs of different markets. So these are, I think, couple of things that we really need to look into. One is the existing feedstock and what do we want to do with that. And then again, involving the community and working with the community to make sure that they generate the kind of feedstock that is required for the industry as we move forward.
Thank you, sir. So I think we're still running out of time. It's time for tea. So we'll not... We continue? Right, right. So I would request Rohit Janji to do the honors for the esteemed panelists.
I would like to thank the eminent panelists for sharing the views. I would like to request to call Mr. Gopal Kishan to hand over the memento to Mr. YB Ramakrishna and Mr. Ashish Kumar. Mr. Gopal Kishan. Please, sir. I would like to invite Mr. Aniket Verma to hand over the memento to Mr. Ankur Mittal. I would like to invite Mr. Shivam Mongia to hand over the memento to Mr. Harvinder Singh and Mr. Snehinder Sharma. I would like to invite Mr. Sunil Malik to hand over the memento to Mr. Dhruvil Goradia and Mr. Yashkaran Singh. Mr. Sunil Malik. Mr. Yashkaran Singh. Colonel Rohit Dev, I request you to hand over the memento to Mr. Anant Bansal. Thank you.